The history of food is, in many ways, the history of humanity. Many anthropologists believe early hominids began cooking between 1.8 and 2.3 million years ago. And that occurrence sparked the chain of events that would create modern humans. Hominids of the Australopithecus genus spent 6 hours a day just chewing, needing large jaws to process all its raw food consumption. The effect of cooking on our evolution is not just demonstrated in modern human smaller jaws, but also in our larger brains. In addition to killing harmful bacteria and parasites, cooking reduced the caloric expenditure it takes to eat and made previously indigestible food edible, unlocking our ability to consume enough calories to enable our brains to grow. The invention of cooking also provided the foundation for human society, and thus many of the specific skills our brains would develop. As hominids stopped eating on the spot of their hunt, they instead gathered around fire, learning to socialize. Labor could be divided between those who cooked, those who hunted, and those who gathered. And tools could be developed to enable better hunting. This state of affairs of hunting and gathering occupied at least 90% of human history. But then came a world-changing event, the invention of agriculture. Agriculture, the practice of cultivating plants and livestock, arose independently in multiple regions of the world during a period known as the Neolithic Revolution. While the earliest evidence shows cultivation of edible grasses as far back as 21,000 BC, around the Sea of Galilee, widespread agricultural practices only took off thousands of years later. The major technological revolution of the Neolithic era was the domestication of plants and animals, meaning selective breeding to make them easier to grow and care for, more abundant, tastier, and otherwise more fit for humanity's needs. The founder crops of wheat, barley, lentils, peas, chickpeas, bitter vetch, and flax were domesticated and cultivated in the Fertile Crescent region around 9,000 BC. Rice was domesticated in multiple parts of the world independently, with the first instance occurring in either East or South Asia between 9,000 to 8,000 BC. Dogs were the first domesticated animals thousands of years earlier. But amongst animals primarily used for slaughter, sheep were first domesticated by 8,000 BC in the Middle East, pigs and cattle in the same region 2,000 years later. In the Americas, squashes, including pumpkins and zucchini, were the first domesticated species around 8,000 BC, followed by maize or corn around 1,000 years later. While hunter-gatherers lived in small tribes of a few dozen people, only building temporary settlements due to the need to constantly migrate to new food sources, agriculture, by enabling more permanent dwellings around food cultivation and the sustenance of larger populations, made civilization possible. Humans specialized and formed more complex organizational structures around the needs of agriculture, developing irrigation systems, granaries, and preservation systems such as drying and fermentation. And the dramatic increase in human productivity agriculture enabled freed up human labor to focus on things other than the immediate need to avoid starvation. Religions and culture developed, with the gods and rituals of early civilizations often centered around agriculture. For example, Tammuz, the Sumerian god of shepherds, vegetation, and crops. Osiris, the Egyptian god of life and grain. And Demeter, the Greek goddess of grain and protector of the harvest. However, the cultural changes were not all good. Oppressive systems like slavery and serfdom would develop around agricultural production, and the breakaway from the diverse hunter-gatherer diet to an over-reliance on a limited variety of staple crops caused nutritional deficiencies. The transition to a grain-based diet led to a reduction in life expectancy, decrease in height, and increase in infant mortality and disease. But overall, the abundance of food permitted by agriculture led to a spike in population, and this serious issue also incentivized trade between civilizations producing different foods, growing the scope of human society. Foods were exchanged between Europe, Asia, and Africa. And after contact with North America in 1492 AD, foods from the New World made their way to Europe and vice versa, greatly affecting culture. Can you imagine Ireland without potatoes? Or an Italy without tomatoes? The dawn of agriculture and the ensuing surplus in available labor led to millennia of increases in technology, including canals, heavy plows, and hydraulic power. But progress was generally slow by today's standard. The next explosive advancements would come by the same means as the first, the advancement of the human mind, this time not by evolution, but by philosophy. The second agricultural revolution started in Britain and the Netherlands around the time of the Enlightenment and was intertwined with its developments in science and legal systems. Mechanization and greater understanding of how to manage arable land and execute selective breeding led to huge increases in food production. For example, the average milk output from a single cow was 140 gallons annually in 1400. By 1800, it was 566. Meanwhile, the enclosure and private ownership of arable land incentivized increased production through profit. This helped ameliorate the tragedy of the commons, in which people raced to use up resources instead of investing in long-term sustainability, as if they did not gather the resources of public lands, then a competitor would. Free markets without tariffs and the expansion of roads and waterways made it possible for food to travel farther. The third agricultural revolution began in the post-World War II era. While the 20th century was also marked by deadly famines, particularly in communist nations experimenting with collectivized farming, centralized economic planning, and the mistaken agricultural theory known as Lysenkoism, other parts of the world had an explosion in agricultural production thanks to the development of synthetic nitrogen fertilizer, pesticides, and more advanced genetic engineering of crops. Although these tools came with trade-offs, as agriculture did from its earliest origins, they are credited with averting starvation for as many as 1 billion people and the widespread reduction of poverty. From 10,000 BC to 1700 AD, the human population grew very slowly, by only about 0.04% annually, starting with 4 million people and ending with 600 million. Today, it is 8 billion, growing at 1% annually, down from 2% 50 years ago. Our planet's population continues to grow, expected to peak around 10.4 billion in the 2080s due to declining birth rates. While about 2.5 billion more people means a lot more potential for likes and subscribes on our videos, it also means new challenges to produce enough food to sustain ourselves. Humanity may need a fourth industrial revolution to survive. Concerns about overpopulation in the tradition of philosopher Thomas Malthus have, however, repeatedly failed to materialize. His present-day disciples, such as Paul Ehrlich, author of the 1968 book, The Population Bomb, have achieved fame both from the mass fear their ideas have caused and the demonstrated falsehoods of their apocalyptic projections. Thus far, humanity has successfully innovated itself out of each limit to our population growth. However, Malthusian fears are not completely unfounded. Half the world's habitable land is already being used for agriculture, with limited arable land to expand. Thus, it is clear we will need to be much more efficient and sustainable with the resources currently available to us. While past performance is no guarantee of future results, the technology to support our future is already well underway. Those most concerned about the potential inability of our food production to meet our needs have pushed some radical solutions. The United Nations, the World Economic Forum, and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation have been some of the largest proponents of introducing insects as a major part of the Western diet. But this has been met with widespread disgust and populist rage at the prospect of political and economic elites forcing such a diet on the masses. Another proposal is to grow and eat more algae, which can be farmed in saltwater oceans, thus expanding the available space on our planet that can be used for agriculture. Jellyfish are also often edible and are at the start of an unexpected population boom. But algae, sludge, and jellyfish are perhaps little more appetizing than bugs. If things truly go badly for humanity, there is one other option, perhaps even grosser, under development that could keep us alive: having fungi mycelium consume and process plastic and other waste to turn it into edible food. Perhaps a more appetizing approach to sustainability is also controversial: genetically modified foods. GMOs have been on the market since the 1990s, but in a sense, we have been genetically modifying our foods since selective breeding began with the dawn of agriculture. Today's technology, however, allows for far more detailed control and alterations of the genes in plants and animals. Aqua Bounty's genetically modified salmon was introduced to the market in 2015. It grows to be market ready in half the time as natural salmon and needs 25% less food. For a pound of feed, they produce about 1.25 pounds for humans to eat. That's a massive improvement, not only over natural salmon, but also compared to 8 pounds of feed it takes to produce 1 pound of beef. Genetically modified golden rice increases the nutrient yield of rice, promising to ameliorate severe vitamin deficiencies in sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia. A wide variety of other genetic modifications in food, both currently on the market and in development, offer to make crops more resistant to pests, viruses, and bacteria, better survive extreme weather, grow larger, taste better, be healthier, and more. However, despite wide scientific consensus that at least the current generation of GMOs are safe, activist groups have expressed concern over their safety and effects on the environment and opposed their use. Another option to make our available land more productive is generally less controversial: technical engineering. High-tech, climate-controlled greenhouses can allow us to produce much more food with the same amount of space. Such greenhouses, currently in use in the Netherlands, are producing 20 times as many tomatoes per square meter as traditional growing techniques, and using 4 times less water to do it. They use special light to increase nutrient yields, and even feature drones to kill moths and other pests. Such greenhouses also allow farmers to replicate any environment on Earth, thus promising access to exotic crops without having to transport them around the world. Greenhouses of the future might also offer vertical farming, building up instead of out. Vertical farms that need less land also offer the opportunity to do agriculture closer to large population centers, also decreasing transport needs. Artificial intelligence is yet another promising technology to make farms less wasteful and more productive. AI robots have been developed that can scan every square centimeter of a field and judge if it needs pollination, fertilizer, or pesticide, and spray it on a micro-targeted basis, using 95% less chemicals than prior methods. However, crops aren't really our largest concern. Livestock is. Meat, aquaculture, eggs, and dairy provide only 37% of humanity's protein and 18% of our calories, but use up 83% of the world's farmland and make up 60% of agricultural greenhouse gas emissions. While climate change is expected in many regions to actually benefit agriculture, with warmer temperatures increasing crop yields, in other regions, climate change may increase droughts, flood coastal farms, contaminate fresh water sources with salt water, and disrupt ecosystems. For those concerned about climate change and less confident in humanity's ability to adapt around it, increasing animal farming to feed our growing population appears to be a terrible option. Luckily, fast-growing companies are offering solutions. Companies such as Impossible Foods and Beyond Meat already offer a wide variety of realistic-tasting fake meat options and are developing more. Impossible Foods touts that its fake beef uses 92% less water, 96% less land, and emits 91% less greenhouse gases than natural beef. However, these hyper-processed foods have been criticized as less healthy than the real thing. Another company, Redefine Meat, uses 3D printers to make their artificial meat take the shape of a realistic-looking steak. Lab-grown meat is another product in development, growing steak from cells. Like their artificial brethren, lab-grown meat could help cut down on animal cruelty and require substantially less land to produce. However, lab-grown meat will never be cheaper than the medium it's grown in. Current experimental products require a serum from pregnant cows to grow, too expensive to be practical. However, synthetic serums are under development, with companies making big bets that this technology can one day cross the finish line. Ultimately, the growth of humanity has always and will continue to be dependent on our ability to feed ourselves. Our economic system and its incentivization of innovation and technological development provides the best tool we have to meet this vitally important challenge. Will humanity be able to do what it takes to produce enough food? Are you willing to eat bugs? Join the conversation and predict the future with us down in the comments. Beyond Now is a new channel dedicated to helping people connect with humanity and the universe's past and to inspire them to dream about the future. We have big plans to create much more content doing just that. In addition to liking, commenting, and subscribing, we hope you'll also consider supporting Beyond Now to enable us to continue making videos and grow our channel by becoming a patron. Our Patreon offers a community to think big with other supporters and to get early access to Beyond Now videos and bonus content. No matter how you choose to support us, we truly appreciate it. We rely on viewer support, and your help enables us to achieve our goal of spreading human connection and inspiration. Thank you so much for watching and supporting Beyond Now.